couple of months ago, I installed UniFi OS server, but it has a problem. Every 4 or 5 days, the CPU locks up and then I have to log in and restart the services. Sometimes I wasn't immediately available to do that, so I started looking for a way to automate. Now, I had heard about N8N for a while and I finally decided to try it out. And I gotta say, N8N is absolutely amazing. And if you haven't started learning it yet, you're missing out on one of the greatest tools that I've used in ages. N8N is a powerful workflow automation tool that you can install locally on your own LAN. In this video, I'm going to walk you through some real-world examples of workflow automations that I've created to save myself a ton of time, and hopefully this is going to open up your eyes to what a superpower learning N8N can be. All right, we've got a lot to cover, so let's get started. I really want to encourage everyone watching this video to go learn N8N because it's absolutely game-changing, all right? I'm an old guy now, okay? And I've been working in IT for close to 30 years. But if I were just starting out in IT today and I was looking for, you know, what would be a good career path, I would probably choose to go all in on no-code automation tools. The types of workflows that you can build with N8N can be incredibly lucrative if you're creating and selling these automations to businesses. Starting with my pesky UniFi OS server issue, I wanted to figure out how to automate the restart of UniFi OS services. Now, I was already monitoring UniFi OS server with Uptime Robot, and Uptime Robot can do webhooks. So I figured that was the best way to trigger this automation. UniFi server is detected as down. Uptime Robot fires off a webhook to N8N to restart the services. Let's take a look. Starting off on the left-hand side, I've got two different ways that I can fire off this workflow. Uptime Robot webhook, or I can execute this manually whenever I need to. Now, Uptime Robot's gonna detect it is down, it's gonna fire off that webhook, and then what I have here is a limit saying, look, if you get that webhook from Uptime Robot, don't process this same workflow more than once every 10 minutes, right? Because I don't want it to start duplicating if the restart takes some time, which I do have some weights in here, it could possibly happen. So this first little section here basically stops UniFi OS server. And this is really cool because I've got an SSH tool here, right? So one of the nodes that you can do in N8N is SSH. And what this does is it uses a secure key to connect out to my UniFi OS server. And I'm using a service user that I created that only has sudo permissions for the UOS server commands. It can't do anything else at a sudo or root level on the server. It can only run these commands. So it's a great little service account. So it uses SSH with private key authentication to log into the server, and it runs the command to stop UniFi OS server. I then log the result, whether it was successful or not. I wait 1 minute and then I run another command that logs in with that private key and it starts UniFi OS server. I then wait another minute and then I do a status check, right? So this logs in one more time and it says, hey, we restarted the services, but let's actually check and make sure that those services were restarted. And if that all works fine, it pushes the date and timestamp along with a success or failure message out to Google Sheets so that I have history of when this automation was run. So this is an example of a very simple automation. It's just SSHing into a server and restarting a service, but it runs autonomously and I don't have to worry about it anymore. And hopefully at some point UniFi fixes this issue with an update, right? And then I can just delete this and I won't need it anymore. With N8N automations, you start with a blank canvas and then you add a trigger that starts the automation. So workflows can be triggered manually, they can be triggered on a schedule, they can fire off like when a new row is added to a spreadsheet or when a form is filled out and then submitted, or when you receive a webhook. And at that point, you're then basically just automating the manipulation of data from point A to point B. Here's another example. All right, we get a ton of support tickets at Rogue Support, and I wanted a way to compare a new ticket with work that we've done in the past. So the idea here is that our techs can paste in a customer's support ticket and then get back suggested questions, a likely solution with a time estimate, as well as potential gotchas, all right? So this automation is what's known as a RAG, or retrieval augmented generation, which basically just means that we're outputting some portion of the workflow to a large language model. But in addition to that, we're using a vector database that's tied to our rogue support ticketing system that has all of the past knowledge from hundreds of successful support tickets. So now when we use this tool for a customer's specific ticket, it can compare what the customer is asking to work that we've done in the past. So here's a very simple web page. This is the Rogue Support Ticket Guru. And we can see if I just paste in, this is just a random ticket that I picked that we received recently. I'm gonna click Analyze Ticket. And then it takes about 15 or 20 seconds and it's gonna give us a result. All right, so there we go. So we have recommended questions that we can ask this customer. We've got a summary of the likely fix for the customer. We've got approximate time estimates. And then we've got a bunch of gotchas that we're gonna wanna look out for as the technician is working on this ticket. So this is a Cloudflare Pages, just simple HTML page. But when you click Analyze Ticket, it fires off a webhook from Cloudflare. It then passes that into this AI agent here, and we have a full prompt that basically generates that output. It sends it to ChatGPT. This is also connected to a vector database, again, that has all of the past history of rogue support tickets, so it can compare what this person is asking to what we've done in the past. And then once it's got all of that processing done, it spits it back out, and then the technicians can just read this or download it or analyze another ticket. So there we have a couple of examples of technical automations, right? But what about some of the non-technical stuff that we have to deal with, right? So for example, whenever we're hiring at Rogue Support, we get absolutely inundated with resumes, okay? And it takes a long time to manually go through each one of those resumes. So I created an automation that streamlines that process, and it's called the Rogue Support Candidate Picker. This automation helps eliminate unqualified candidates immediately and then brings the best candidates up to the surface so that we are only manually reviewing the best of the best. It saves a ton of time. So this is a manually triggered automation. I can just run it whenever I need to. And basically we have the applicants in a Google Sheets. Now, I could set it up so that the form that they fill out goes straight to that Google Sheets. I haven't done that yet, but I certainly could if I wanted to automate this even further. The first thing we do is we check, hey, is this person international, right? We don't hire international technicians with Rogue Support. So if they've filled out the form and they're from a different country, they're just not qualified. So we just immediately get rid of that one. And then once again, we are messaging a large language model, and I've got a full prompt that is weighted for exactly what I want to see in a Rogue Support candidate, right? It evaluates their customer service capability, it evaluates their resume and past history, it evaluates what knowledge they've told us that they have, and it evaluates their availability, right? So all of those things are weighted and scored, and then I get a score out of 100 for every candidate that has filled out an application. And then once they've scored, I take any candidate that scores 81 to 100, and I create a summarized document, a summarized Google Doc that tells me all about the candidate and why they are an ideal choice and gives me their final score. And then we can set up interviews with those, you know, best of the best candidates. And then if I wanted to, I could automate this even further and send those qualified candidates an email that has like a calendar link so they can schedule an interview appointment with the company. This type of automation that I set up, this took me probably 2 hours to build, but in the most recent run of Rogue Support technicians that came through, we had over 50 resumes received. And this sorted through all of them and brought the top 15 to our attention, right? So rather than me having to go through every single resume one by one, I'm only looking for the ones that match my specific criteria and scored the highest. So basically we're, you know, separating the wheat from the chaff, if you will, and then my time is saved by not having to go through those extra 35 resumes. And finally, the most complicated automation that I've set up so far is also not really a super technical automation. It's for aggregating RSS feeds and looking for topics that I'm specifically interested in, right? Cybersecurity and networking and VoIP and AI advancements. Articles that match my criteria are then summarized and delivered directly to a Discord channel so that I can keep up to date with the latest news. And the way that this works is it fires off every 6 hours, and then I've got a Google sheet that has all of the different RSS feeds that I want to monitor. So if I ever want to change this or, you know, add, remove sources, I can just add another RSS feed to that Google sheet and it's going to pick it up in this automation. I then have a loop here which takes each RSS feed one by one and shoots it over to a child workflow. So this is a parent workflow, then we've got a child workflow that also works hand in hand with this one. And then here is the child workflow. Basically, each one of those RSS feeds is sent to this child workflow individually, and then I pull out each article that has come in the previous 6 hour period, and I send it over to a large language model. In this case, it's Anthropic. And that has a prompt that basically says, hey, read this article, and this is the criteria that I'm looking for. This is the stuff that I'm interested in. So score this, you know, 1 to 5, and if it meets, you know, 4 or 5 on a particular topic, then send it to Discord. And then in Discord here, we can see I've got 21 new messages right now. It tells me what the article is about, just sort of a general category, the title of the article, and then a link to the article, as well as a couple of bullet points that summarize what the article is all about. So now, rather than having to go out and scroll through all of these various RSS feeds to try to find the information that I want and look through all of their articles, I just input all of the RSS feeds that I want to monitor, and then this automation scans through them 4 times a day, pulls out articles that are relevant to me, and delivers them to me instead of me having to go out and look for them. So again, the idea here is this just saves me a ton of time. And these are just the automations that I've created in the past month or so since I started learning N8N. But I've already got a ton of other ideas for ways that I can utilize this tool. And once you comprehend what you can do with workflow automation, it really starts to open your brain up to a bunch of different possibilities and you start thinking differently, right? Is this something that I can automate? How much time could I save myself if I built this specific tool? And while, yes, this is definitely a huge rabbit hole to go down, right? I've had great success using Claude or Gemini to step me through each node of the workflow process and troubleshoot why things aren't working the way they're supposed to. So while you're learning, augmenting what you're trying to do with an LLM is, you know, basically a superpower at this point. So then how can you try this for yourself? N8N is designed to be self-hosted via Docker. Now, I've got mine set up to run in Container Manager on my Synology NAS, and it's been working perfectly. N8N is free, and then if you register with your email, you actually can unlock some extra features. Once N8N is up and running, you then just connect to it on its LAN IP at port 5678. Now, this is HTTP only at this point, and also only available on your LAN. So if you want to expose it to the internet, there are a couple of ways to do that. You could stand up a simple, you know, caddy file plus let's encrypt Docker container as a proxy and then port forward through your firewall. But, you know, that might not be ideal if your internet connection has a dynamic IP address that may change on you. If you use something like DigitalOcean, they've already got like one-click installs for N8N. You could just stand up an N8N virtual machine in the cloud. For my N8N that's running on my Synology NAS, I set up secure remote access through Cloudflare tunnels because I already had Cloudflare tunnels up and running on my own network. Now, I did do a full video tutorial on how to set up and use Cloudflare tunnels, and I'll put a link to that down in the description. The advantage with Cloudflare tunnels is that Cloudflare handles the fully qualified domain name as well as the secure certificate, and it even allows you to do fancy stuff like use your Google account for authentication. So it's pretty easy to get installed, but there is definitely a learning curve, especially if you've never used this kind of no-code automation tool before. N8N does have a full beginner course on YouTube to get you started. It's about 2 hours worth of content, but it is well worth your time. Tell me down in the comments, do you guys use N8N? And if so, what have you created? How have these automations changed your daily grind and saved you time? I'd love to hear about it. And if you'd like to keep this party going, I have hand-selected a couple of videos on the right here for you to watch next. The top video features my recent trip to Los Angeles where I fixed my buddy's crappy Wi-Fi, and the bottom video is an in-depth look at whether or not TP-Link is spying on you.